I'm drinking cider this video. I've got a blanket because I didn't want to put a jumper on because I have this cute Christmas top that they ask us to wear at work, so I wanted to leave it on, but then that also meant that I would be cold. So I have a blanket as well. Hee hee. Oh, hello, there's a cat. Apparently, if I'm gonna film at night in my living room, like I did with the imposter syndrome video, we're just gonna get cats that want to be a part of it. I'm gonna have to deal with that. I'm sure you don't really mind because it's my cats, they're adorable.
There's nothing wrong with me making cameos today.
You're such a cute little sweet baby. Anyway, so today, do you mind? Do you mind? Do you mind, baby? Okay, kids. So today, Ffion wants to be a nerd. Ffion is a nerd and she wants to share her nerdiness with you. So as you may or may not know, I studied a degree in physics. I went to uni for 3 years to learn about physics, the physical principles of the world and how it works in the universe. And one of the more interesting parts that I kind of found was learning about the different physicists that have over the years made the breakthrough in order for us to understand the world in the way that we do now, you know, because these like breakthroughs sort of had to happen over many years, and lots of different people, like the person I'm going to talk about today, people you might know about like Einstein and Newton, some others that you might not know about unless you've studied more sciencey things or studied physics yourself, like Schrodinger, lots of people. I don't know why Schrodinger's the only one I can come up with, probably because I've got my cats with me, and when I think of Schrodinger, I think of Schrodinger's cat, which by the way, in this series, I'm probably gonna make a video on Schrodinger because I have a tattoo based around Schrodinger's cat, and he as a person just really, really fascinates me as well as the person that I'm going to start this series on. So yeah, you've probably seen in the title, but this series is going to be me being a nerd, talking about physicists. Ffion talks physicist. Don't we love a little bit of alliteration? Yes, we do. So try and get you guys who may or may not have any level of interest in science or the people that brought about the science as we understand it today. I'm gonna try and get you interested in those people because I'm interested in them, and I feel like there's more to them than being like white men in beards who did some smarts and got Nobel prizes and shit. Like there's more to these people than that, and I wanna, you know, talk to you about that kind of stuff instead. And the person that I wanna talk about today is one that kind of, I want a tattoo related to him as well. Like obviously I have a tattoo based around Schrodinger, but I want a tattoo based around this guy as well, because I'll tell you a bit about his story in a minute. Obviously that's the whole point of the video, but he kind of has a place in my heart because of, you know, what he's been through. So I love him, and you'll see basically why he has a place in my heart. And yeah, that guy is Ludwig Boltzmann. So again, if you have studied physics, you'll know who that guy is. He's the guy who came up with Boltzmann's constant, and obviously much more around that. He's the guy who proposed kinetic theory of gases. He was an atomist, which, as we'll discover, is something that kind of caused a lot of conflict in his life, because at the time, many people were anti-atomists and they believed that the universe was energy-centric, like the makeup of the universe was based on energy more than it was these little tiny particles that can kind of like bounce around and interact with each other. So there's a conflict between the atomists and the anti-atomists, and that's kind of what made a big negative impact on Boltzmann's life. But yeah, we'll get into that. I've got a bunch of notes that I'm going to read from, because otherwise I'll forget what I'm trying to talk about. But I kind of give you a brief overview there of like who he is and what he made his major breakthroughs in. So Ludwig Boltzmann lived in between 1844 and 1906. He was a guy from Austria and was like born in Vienna and is, like I said, well known for being a physicist, but he also considered himself a bit of a philosopher as well, and he kind of, throughout his life, tried to stress the distinction between physics and philosophy, because obviously there's a big part of the world that you would imagine is very intertwined between the two. Physics is the physical definitive laws of how matter and everything interacts with each other, and philosophy is sort of more seen as, you know, ethics, the way that people interact with each other, you know, like the way that morals, the way people's morals should be because of how the world works, and, you know, like why the world is the way it is sort of more of a philosophical thing, but it's also a physics thing, you know? So he kind of saw himself as both of those things, but he wanted to stress distinguish between the two, because they are less intertwined in his eyes than a lot of people saw. So yeah, like I said, he's very known for his important breakthroughs in statistical mechanics, but we're gonna get more into his life as a person. So he kind of grew up in a fairly wealthy family, and was, I think, tutored privately, but sadly the guy lost his dad at 15 years old, so he's already experiencing, I nearly dropped my phone, he's already experiencing some degree of, you know, difficulties in his life at that young age, because no one should lose a parent that young. So in 1863 he went to uni in Vienna, University of Vienna, to study physics. Yeah, and in the 3 years sort of following that, he eventually got his PhD, which he wrote his dissertation on, the kinetic theory of gases. Now, I'm really gonna try not to make this video too physics based. I'm gonna try not to talk too much about the physics itself, because that's not what's important, but, you know, little bits and bobs here and there I will explain, so that I'm not, like, you know, me just saying his dissertation was on the kinetic theory of gases to somebody who doesn't study physics is like I'm talking gobbledygook. But to, like, simplify that, that just means his dissertation was on the way in which the smallest parts of matter interacted with each other. So, like, this pillow and this can is made up, if you break it down to the tiniest little bits in it, of particles, and though we can't see it, those little particles are honestly, like, moving around all the time because they have energy, and they're, like, bumping into each other and transferring energy, and the air in the room is made of these same particles, but they're more spread out as they are a gas. And, you know, if you confine these gases to a specific space, then they're going to bounce off walls and transfer energy, and they're going to bounce off each other and transfer energy, and those sorts of things are what are called, like, the macro states, is like the configurations of the particles in this enclosed space because of, like, how much they might bump into each other or bump into the walls, sort of thing. And there's also a thing called microstates within this sort of whole kinetic theory of gases. But honestly, at that point, I get lost, so I'm not gonna blabber on any further than that. It's basically, he studied how matter at the tiniest level sort of interacts with each other, at least as was understood at that time. So, the atom. So some guy called Joseph Stefan was one of his, like, main important teachers throughout him studying his degree, and then he eventually became this guy's assistant after being a lecturer for a few years in 1867. He kind of then throughout his life moved around universities and different places and worked as a lecturer or researcher. So he worked as a professor at some place called University of Graz. I don't know how to say that. I think it's some Austrian word. I don't know how to say it in a more Austrian way. But again, if you know physics, he worked with people like Bunsen, Kirchhoff, and Helmholtz over his time at the University of Graz. So they're, like, well-known people. if you imagine the Bunsen burner back when you did science at GCSE level, if you're in the UK, you may or may not know what I'm saying, but there we go. He worked with those sorts of people at that time. So then in 1872, he met his future wife, this woman called Henrietta, and at the time, when it obviously it's the 1800s, the middle of the 1800s, women are not very accepted generally. Men are thought of as higher, women are thought of as people who are only supposed to be wives and mothers of children, and to stay at home and just do that as their role and that's it. But Henrietta wanted to be a physics and maths sort of teacher, and she aspired to do that, but she was obviously met with difficulty in this endeavour because she's a woman. But you know, Ludwig and Henrietta met, and he supported her in trying to fight these people that were pushing her down in her pursuit of being a teacher. And you know, she eventually made it and she became a maths teacher, and the two of them fell in love and they got married and eventually had children. So it all worked out for them in the end, in a way, in that sense. So like I said, this place, the University of Graz, is sort of the main place that he did most of his work, but like he did do bits and bobs of work in different universities across Germany and Austria. I'll put in like text notes in places if I've made a mistake there, but I think I'm right. Yeah, I think we'll just follow my notes in order, otherwise I'm gonna get confused. Like I said before, he was an atomist. He strongly believed in the fact that matter is broken down into these tiny little particles, and these tiny little particles are, you know, sort of the basis of how physics operates at a small level, and that's how energy gets transferred. But a lot of people believed that atoms were just a sort of theoretical thing, that they were sort of supposed to just be a symbol of how energy communicates with each other at the small levels to make up things like these sofas and the pillow and my can. Some people thought it was all just energy and the atoms were theoretical. So he spent a lot of his years, his final years, fighting to get people to understand his theories and to accept his theories, because he, yes, a lot of his work was mainly theoretical and mathematical, but he strongly, strongly believed that that was the way that the world worked, and he wanted so badly for people to understand that and to accept it and to recognise the brilliance of his work. But a lot of people just didn't understand that, and he kind of kept getting met with discouragement after discouragement after discouragement, because anti-atomists would put forward ideas that sort of disproved what he was talking about, or you know, fought against what he was talking about, and it didn't make him feel good, as you would imagine. So yeah, he spent a lot of his final years defending his theories against many big physicists who were strongly in favour of theories that wildly disagreed with his. In his later life as well though, he also spent some time as a lecturer of philosophy, and became sort of well known and popular, very very popular in fact, for his natural philosophies, and some of his lectures were so widely popular and attended that there weren't enough seats in the lecture theatre and people were sat on the stairs. I don't want to get to the heartbreaking bit already, but it is the next bit in my notes. What makes this video sort of connect with some of my other work on YouTube is in mental health related fields, is that Boltzmann did end up ending his own life, and not in small part because everything he fought for, all of his work, was just shat on for the most part by a lot of people, and he couldn't really take that, and his mental health deteriorated in his final years because he felt that no one understood him and no one was seeing the world in the way that he did so strongly. And yeah, he, in 1906, he hung himself when he was on holiday with his wife and kids, which is just so, so very heartbreaking that that's what it came to for him. And honestly, what makes it so much worse is that not 5 years after he ended his own life, further work was put forward that proved that everything that he was telling everyone, all the work that he did, was absolutely true and, you know, proven to be true and how the world really is working. And his work became like the cornerstone of quantum mechanics and statistical mechanics, as I said before. Physicists now, like I did, studied his work as one of, you know, one of the fundamental theories of physics. It's that important, and it was only seen as such and like recognized and accepted after his death. And it just, the moment I found out, because we got told this in lectures about the guy, because one of our lecturers was really, really good and kind of made it more interesting in the sense that when he was talking about the different physical theories and principles, he would, you know, give us little tidbits and facts and, you know, the history of the people that found these things out, like Boltzmann himself. And when I was told that this man killed himself, and only after he did that was his theories widely accepted and like the importance of them understood, it's just really, really heartbreaking, because he didn't get to see that happen. He ended his life thinking that all of his life's work was useless and pointless and, you know, just fundamentally wrong and not good enough, and everything he believed in just would never be, you know, what was right, what was good enough, you know. I'm just so sad for him that that happened, and to know that such an incredibly intelligent man and such a influential man didn't see how like amazing he was and how important he was and how remembered in the study of science he would be for many, many years to come after his work and after his death. Yeah, it's just so sad that he didn't get to know that, as many other physicists did. He never got a Nobel Prize for his work. He died thinking it was all wrong, and it wasn't, it was right. And, you know, there's a constant named after him now. The kinetic theory of gases is one of the fundamental things that you learn throughout your degree, first, second year. You know, Boltzmann is so important. Anything Boltzmann related is very, very important to basic physical principles in sort of, like I said, statistical, quantum, and classical mechanics. He kind of is important to all of those, and it just baffles me that he didn't get to see the fruits of his labour. Yeah, what I've written here is only after his death were his works in physics seen as the resounding success they were and proven correct against the beliefs of his critics. Yeah, the Boltzmann entropy formula is inscribed on his gravestone, which I also thought was pretty cool. Like, the actual formula itself is one of the things on his gravestone. I think one day I would really love to go see his gravestone, because of, yeah, just sort of the impact that this man has had on me. And yeah, I just think it would be very, very cool. Ernest Mach and a guy called Ostwald didn't believe in the existence of atoms, and Boltzmann did, and based his entire work around the concept. These other philosophers and physicists believed in an energy-centered universe instead. That's two kind of specific people that fought against him and made him feel so discouraged and shat on. Yeah, during the 1890s, he put forward work to try to please both the atomists and the anti-atomists, but he was met with discouragement even then, because neither side was, you know, satisfied with the way he formulated his argument, which again is so sad. Yeah, people weren't a fan of how statistical an approach he took to thermodynamics, because it was, you know, considered to, you know, sully the purity of thermodynamics, which I don't really get, to be frank, but yeah, people just had this viewpoint of pure thermodynamics, and Boltzmann's theory didn't really comply with that, so they just rejected it, refused to believe it. And I feel like that's a common occurrence in, you know, the progression of science. People get stuck in their ways and their thinking of, you know, the world is this way, that is it, that it's fundamentally this way and it cannot be anything different. So when someone up and coming puts forward an idea that contradicts with that, they refuse to believe them no matter what evidence they put forward that proves or, you know, supports the viewpoint that they believe, which is contradictory to them. And it, you know, I get it, because you don't, if you have such a settled viewpoint of the universe and how it works and everything around you, you don't like the idea of it being anything different, because, you know, that would just blow your mind too much, you know, you just get existential and I don't know, you just don't want that to be shaken up. But people should really have been more open-minded about different viewpoints. Yeah, because even like if you're met with like so much evidence and, you know, supporting factors that would make this other viewpoint feel more correct than your viewpoint, why would you still be so much in denial? But that's just the way that a lot of people have been throughout history, which is kind of shitty, but it's just the way it is, I guess. Yeah, Boltzmann was made deeply depressed by the growing viewpoints and interpretations of other works threatening the end of his own research. In 1904, there was this like big physics conference in St. Louis, and the physics panel included a lot of people who were anti-atomists. And so he wasn't invited to be on the physics side of it, and instead was more shoved over onto the philosophy side. No, it wasn't the philosophy, it was shoved over onto the kind of applied mathematics area, which was obviously much to his dismay, because he was strongly in belief of, you know, wanting to push his own work in the physics side of things, but he was just being rejected, not supported by these people. So even shoved over into this other side of the conference, he spoke up about his viewpoints and, you know, like I said before, tried to argue that physics and philosophy should not be so intertwined or thought of as intertwined, and it just wasn't met with much encouragement. He was just rejected a lot. My camera's running out of battery, so I don't know if I'm gonna get through all